गुड आफ्टरनून। हेलो।
गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
ओके।
हाँ
यू ऑल कैन हियर क्लियरली।
यस सर।
देर इज सम लैग एक्चुअली या टेक्निकल। वन सेकेंड। ओके देन आई विल स्टार्ट राइट।
ओके सर।
सम मोर रिस्पॉन्सेज।
यस
ओके
सर।
ओके 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 देन आई विल स्टार्ट। ओके ओके सो टुडे वी विल कवर द रेनल फेलियर। बेसिकली यू नो मोस्ट ऑफ इट ऑलरेडी because we have discussed it in different classes, but still there is one class for renal failure, so we'll just cover the important points superficially about renal failure. Now in kidney this is the chapter, this is the class which is the last class of the medical renal disease. After that there will be one class on renal tumors and one on bladder tumors. With that we'll finish the renal system, and after that we'll have MCQs. So maybe in between I'll give you some assignments and I'll tell what all are the important questions and all, at least so that you can prepare accordingly, not only in MCQs but in short questions and long questions and all. So today we'll finish renal failure, then next class will be renal tumors, and then we'll finish with bladder tumor. After that maybe one class we'll take for some revision and all if you want. Let us see how it goes. Then we'll have MCQs of renal system, and also we'll have MCQs of GIT and hepatobiliary together in one class. Then after that we will go to the next chapter or next system, that is endocrine. It is understood, all of you? Followed, right?
Yes sir.
Yes sir.
Okay, okay. And in renal system also you please read that practical notebook, what is there. I already uploaded that. And because it is important not only in practical but also in the MCQs, there may be some MCQs from that. And later on when there may be practical exams online which is not yet decided, but if it is there then questions will be there from that. Actually it will be asked or you may have to write all these things. MCQs, I'll include MCQs at least from that right now. So the important tests and what all are the important findings and the principle, those things you have to read. Okay, not many pages are there, only few pages. So we'll start with renal failure. So as you know, we divide renal failure into two types. One is acute and chronic. Now these days they have changed some nomenclature, and acute renal failure is also called as acute kidney injury, and chronic renal failure is also called as chronic kidney disease. Anyway, we'll be using acute renal failure and chronic renal failure only, but these days in the clinical side more they're using the word acute kidney injury and chronic kidney disease, AKI and CKD. So first, what is renal failure? That you already know, that basically like any other organ failure, here also the function of kidney will not be adequate. So what happens is the renal excretory function will be inadequate. So failure of renal excretory function due to low GFR. So basically the glomerular filtration rate will be reduced, and depending on the time duration, how long it goes, it will lead to mild to marked or profound azotemia and features of uremia. As you may remember, earlier we discussed in the initial classes that when the excretory products like urea, nitrogen, they are accumulated in the body, then the biochemical aspect of it is called as azotemia. That means elevation of excretory products in the blood is called as azotemia, while the clinical aspect is called as uremia. Means when the azotemia is manifested as clinical features, clinical sign and symptoms, then we call it as uremia. Basically same thing, biochemical part is azotemia and clinical part is uremia. And they are often associated with other renal dysfunction and metabolic abnormality. So there can be other renal dysfunction also. So one of them is important is there may be secondary hypertension and metabolic abnormalities will be there, which will come to in short. So already we discussed it earlier. Once again, just for recap. So azotemia is biochemical abnormality and it is characterized by increased blood urea nitrogen and creatinine. So these are the excretory products which are supposed to be excreted from the body, but because the glomerular filtration rate is not adequate, they will be accumulated in the body. And this is caused by decreased GFR and three types: prerenal, renal and postrenal. Anyone, can you say what are the examples of prerenal azotemia?
Shock.
Okay, shock is one. Renal, anyone? Renal
glomerular nephritis.
All glomerular nephritis. Okay, correct. And postrenal
obstruction.
Obstruction. Okay, fine. So the same thing as you said. So prerenal azotemia means the renal function itself is normal, but still there is low GFR because the renal perfusion is less. So for example, shock is the most important one, hemorrhage and congestive cardiac failure. So these will lead to renal ischemia. There will be less renal perfusion and obviously the GFR also will be less than adequate. Next is renal azotemia, when the renal parenchymal disease, basically the primary defect, and for example acute tubular necrosis, and as you said also glomerulonephritis ultimately may lead to chronic renal failure and azotemia. Postrenal azotemia is secondary to urinary tract obstruction, right? And what is uremia? Uremia is the clinical abnormality and it is caused by azotemia. So it is characterized by a group of clinical signs and symptoms. Usually it affects almost all the organ systems. So due to several metabolic and endocrine abnormality involving several organ systems, almost all organ systems will be affected basically. So there will be several metabolic and endocrine abnormality, and ultimately there will be all the organ systems of the body will be affected. Okay. Now we'll come to this. Already we know that there are two types of renal failure. One is acute, one is chronic. Acute is also called as acute kidney injury, and chronic is also called as chronic kidney disease. Now, what is the example of acute renal failure? Anyone?
Acute tubular necrosis.
Okay, and chronic renal failure can happen because of chronic glomerulonephritis, which may be because of any of the glomerulonephritis, whatever we have discussed, ultimately may lead to chronic glomerulonephritis, including RPGN or all this membranous or whatever nephrotic syndrome causes, like membranous or membrane proliferative or focal segmental, all may lead to chronic renal failure, right? Now, anyone, do you, can you say that which one usually does not go to chronic renal failure? Anyone?
Minimal change
disease. Minimal change disease, correct. Okay. Fine. Absolutely fine. Okay. So I continue with acute renal failure or acute kidney injury. So as the name is saying, acute. So there will be onset will be rapid. So already you know that. So there will be rapid decline of GFR. Okay. So rapid decline of GFR within hours to days, and there will be acute onset of azotemia. There may be oliguria or anuria, and sometimes at the later stage there may be polyuria. There will be tubular dysfunction, and usually this acute renal failure is because of severe injury to tubules or glomerulus or interstitium or blood vessels. Ultimately will lead to acute renal failure. Most important example is acute tubular necrosis, as you said. Usually they are reversible. Usually reversible provided treatment is started soon. So if treatment is started soon, then usually they are reversible. Now here also, like azotemia, basically is somewhat similar. We can classify into pre-renal, renal, and post-renal. And pre-renal is decreased perfusion leading to decreased GFR and shock, hemorrhage, and congestive cardiac failure. In renal, intrinsic renal causes here, in some cases, RPGN may lead to rapid downfall or downhill deterioration of renal function, and that may lead to acute renal failure. The most common cause is acute tubular necrosis. Also, in some cases, there may be acute interstitial nephritis because of some infection or some inflammation. So that also may lead to acute renal failure. But here, most important is ATN from exam point of view. Post-renal is secondary to urinary tract obstruction. Okay. If there is sudden urinary tract obstruction and complete obstruction, then there will be acute renal failure. Now, what all are the different stages of ATN in clinicals? Clinically, what all are the different stages? Anyone?
Ischemic nephrotoxic.
Yeah, no, actually in between, I think, 1 second. Okay. Now, what I'm asking is, in acute tubular necrosis, let us discuss a little bit, revise acute tubular necrosis. What are the two types? One is, as you said, ischemic. Another type is?
Ischemic and toxic.
Toxic type. What are the differences? Anyone
from class? Site and tubular axis.
Correct. One is site, one is tubular axis. So what site it will be in ischemic? What site it will be in the toxic? What site it will be in the toxic?
Proximal tubule.
Proximal tubule will be affected in the toxic. And in ischemic, most important is loop of Henle, ascending part of loop of Henle will be affected, right? And tubular axis will be seen in which one?
Ischemic.
Yes?
Ischemic.
Yes, ischemic. Ischemic, okay, correct. Okay, so it will be in the ischemic. What do you mean by tubular axis?
Rupture of tubular basement membrane.
Which basement membrane? Glomerular?
Tubular
basement membrane. You have to say it clearly that tubular axis means rupture of tubular basement membrane. Correct. And what all are the clinical phases? Three phases were there.
Initiating phase,
maintenance phase, and recovery phase. Right? Okay. initiating phase is for how long duration?
36 hours.
36 hours. Okay, approximately 36 hours, right? So we'll come to the same thing once again, that is stages, especially in ATN. And this is more applicable. That is, there is one initiating, then maintenance, and then recovery phase. The initiating phase is for about 36 hours. And in this phase, the urine volume will start reducing and BUN level will start rising. In the maintenance phase, those will be profound. Means that in the maintenance phase, the reduction of urine volume will be marked. There may be oliguria or anuria, and BUN level will be markedly increased. And another thing is potassium level will be high. There may be metabolic acidosis, renal tubular acidosis. Just to, at least you remember that there will be metabolic acidosis because there are different types and all under this, and you don't have to really remember the pathogenesis of how acidosis is happening. If someone is interested, you may read, especially in medicine, it will be medicine books, it will be given. And the basic idea is there will be less cation excretion, hydrogen ion, and more excretion of bicarbonate. So that leads to acidosis. But again, in this, there are different types and it is quite complex. Right now, it is not there in your syllabus. That's why I am not discussing about it. So RTA, there are three types, 1, 2, and 4. Three types are there. And third phase is recovery phase. So here, patient will start recovering, urine volume will be increased, and in ATN especially, there may be polyuria because tubular concentrating function will be not proper, not adequate. That's why there may be polyuria. And sometimes there may be low potassium. Okay, so these three phases we already discussed earlier. And how is the prognosis of acute renal failure? It is medical emergency, usually reversible if treated on time. But if not treated on time or if treatment is delayed, then death may happen in many cases. So urgent treatment is important. And if treatment is given properly on time, it is mostly reversible. All right. Before this, did we study any condition here in kidney which is medical emergency? Any of you? Means urgently patient has to be taken to hospital and treated. Yes?
Berry aneurysm,
correct. That is one we have that we discussed under which topic? Berry aneurysm. Under adult polycystic kidney disease. Okay, under adult polycystic kidney disease, we discussed berry aneurysm. That is one emergency. I agree with that. Anything else?
Malignant nephrosclerosis
and malignant hypertension. Correct. Okay. Malignant hypertension is, what is the definition? There will be severe rise of blood pressure, which is systolic is more than what and diastolic is more than what? Or how much it will be?
Systolic more than 200 and diastolic more than 130.
Diastolic is more than?
130.
Okay. 130. Some books says 120, but usually here I have written 130. Whatever you say is okay. And the systolic will be more than 200 millimeter of mercury. Okay. Right. Okay. Now we'll come to chronic renal failure. Now, the other name these days, they say CKD or chronic kidney disease. And it is of prolonged onset with slow decline of GFR over several months. In acute, it was hours to days. Here it is months. Usually, the definition is at least 3 months. Okay. So, what is the definition? So, definition is diminished glomerular filtration rate that is persistently less than 60 ml per minute per 1.73 meter square of body surface area. Usually that is the standard body surface area which is taken. So 60 ml per minute is the unit you have to remember. Okay, so if it is less than that, and that also for at least 3 months from any cause, then it is called as chronic renal failure, and or persistent albuminuria may be there. It may be there, may not be there, and or. Okay, so persistent albuminuria may be there, may not be there, but what is important is less than 60 ml per minute. So these units are little, important actually, not only little, I mean, it is of quite importance. So you have to remember, say, for example, in nephrotic syndrome, we say which is per day and which is per deciliter, that you have to remember. Okay, proteinuria is per day. Albuminemia, when we say hypoalbuminemia, then it is per deciliter. Here it is per minute, 60 ml per minute. Okay. And clinically, in most of these CKD patients or chronic renal failure patients, there will be uremia. And the major cause of death from renal disease, from any renal diseases, ultimately patient will have if they are not getting treatment properly, or even they are getting treatment, many of them will ultimately will not respond properly and may go to chronic renal failure. That we already discussed earlier. So a major cause of death from any renal disease, ultimately they will go to chronic renal failure. So this also we discussed earlier, that there are four stages of evolution of CRF or CKD. First was diminished renal reserve, when GFR is up to 50%. Renal insufficiency, when GFR is 20 to 50%. Chronic renal failure, this word is usually used when it is less than 20 to 5%. And end stage renal disease is when it is less than 5%. Now, among all these four, most important is the last one, which you must remember. Okay. So this one you must remember, last one, that end stage renal disease is when it is less than 5%. That is the most severe stage, and obviously after that patient has to go for dialysis or transplant. Prognosis is very, very poor after that. Okay. Now we'll come to the etiology or causes of chronic renal failure. So basically, whatever we have discussed till now, anything and everything may lead to chronic renal failure, except two things. One is minimal change disease, which usually does not go to chronic renal failure, and another is acute tubular necrosis, which usually presents as acute renal failure. Otherwise, everything or all whatever we have discussed, any renal disease may go to chronic renal failure. Commonest cause is diabetes and hypertension. Okay. Now, what all the conditions, what all we have discussed in now, like primary glomerulonephritis, under that we have discussed RPGN, under nephritic syndrome we have discussed post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis, under nephrotic we have discussed about membranous, membranoproliferative, focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. Under secondary glomerulonephritis, for example, most important is diabetes. Next is other conditions other than glomerulonephritis, whatever we discussed, like chronic pyelonephritis. Tuberculosis we have not discussed as such in any class in theory, but this also may lead to, because it is a chronic infection, so tuberculosis of kidney may lead to chronic renal failure. The nephrosclerosis, especially in the malignant one, or also in some cases in benign nephrosclerosis also, calculi or nephrocalcinosis, and polycystic kidney disease. So all these may lead to chronic renal failure. So basically any disease, as I said, usually except minimal change disease and acute tubular necrosis. So these two usually don't go to chronic renal failure. All of you are listening to me? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Raise your hand. Okay, raise it once. Let me see how many of you are awake. Yes. Okay. Fine. So okay, let me finish this topic. After that, few things I'll just repeat once again. Okay, and just for revision, so that will be helpful for your 71. Okay. Now let us come to what all the clinical features of chronic renal failure and uremia. You can see right clearly.
Yes,
okay. So what all are the systemic features of chronic renal failure and uremia? Basically all the different organs may be affected, as I said, and there will be imbalance in fluid and electrolytes, and also there will be metabolic abnormalities. So first we'll come to fluid and electrolyte disturbances. Under that, there will be dehydration, there will be edema. Okay, basically dehydration means there will be less volume in the intravascular fluid. Okay, so intravascular fluid will be less, but tissue edema will be present. Okay, there may be because the protein is getting excreted, so there will be hypoalbuminemia, and that will lead to edema. So dehydration and edema, and there will be metabolic acidosis. Already we said that there will be renal tubular acidosis. In acute renal failure, here also there may be acidosis, metabolic acidosis, and increased potassium level or hyperkalemia. Now next is bone and calcium metabolism. So here this one is a bit important, which is asked specifically, that is renal osteodystrophy. Osteodystrophy means some abnormality in the bone, okay, and that is because of kidney or because of lack of proper function of kidney, basically. So that's why it is called as renal osteodystrophy. Okay, so abnormality or disease of bone because of renal cause, that's why it is called as renal osteodystrophy. We will come to this thing in a bit more detail. Next is increased phosphate level, low calcium level, and secondary hyperparathyroidism. So this we have to know a bit, because this one is asked in the exam, in the Viva, and sometimes it is important for MCQs also. So this one we have to understand. So initially, as we know, that kidney is not functioning properly, so disease kidney in chronic renal failure. So that, as the kidney is not functioning properly, two things will happen. One is phosphate excretion will be low, and vitamin D hydroxylation will be affected. Okay, you remember where vitamin D hydroxylation, which all two organs where it is seen?
Liver and kidney.
Liver and kidney. Okay. Yes, tell, please tell. Someone told something more.
Okay. So cell proximal tubule.
Okay. Very good. So this vitamin D will be less, and phosphate excretion will be decreased. As phosphate excretion is decreased, the level of phosphate in blood will be increased. Okay. And on the other hand, as the vitamin D production is less, or hydroxylation is less, so vitamin D overall affects the calcium level. So as the vitamin D is less, calcium level will be less. So the ultimately what we'll see is low calcium and high phosphate. So to compensate that, there will be release of PTH. PTH is parathyroid hormone. Okay, that is released from parathyroid. Now what is the function of parathyroid hormone, anyone?
It increases
the
calcium level.
It will try to raise the calcium. It will activate osteoclast, and it will try to raise the calcium level in blood. Okay, so function of PTH is to raise the calcium. So because the calcium level is low and phosphate level is high, as a result of that, PTH will be released by parathyroid hormone, and that will lead to increased resorption of calcium from bone. Okay, so to try to compensate the low calcium level, the calcium from bone will come to blood. So basically, the bone will have less calcium. So that is called as renal osteodystrophy. Okay, so here you remember that phosphate level will be high in blood because there will be less phosphate excretion, and in the blood also calcium level will be low, as a result of that increased PTH. Okay, so this you have to remember, this is important. PTH will try to compensate the calcium, but as the kidney disease is continuing, it is a chronic disease, so it will go on. Okay, so as a result of that, calcium will continue to come out from bone, resorption will be continuing, and bone will be fragile. Okay, so this is okay. So what we discussed under bone and calcium metabolism, renal osteodystrophy, increased phosphate level because the excretion of phosphate is less, low calcium level is because the vitamin D production or hydroxylation is less, and secondary hyperparathyroidism is because of these two, basically low calcium and increased phosphate. Low calcium is more important, that will lead to increased parathyroid hormone, and as the parathyroid hormone is being secreted because of low calcium level, so that's why it is secondary. Okay, again later on in parathyroid, when we'll be discussing parathyroid, then under endocrine system, that time we'll be discussing. So that's why it is secondary hyperparathyroidism. Okay, any doubt till now? Okay, so now on the last portion, that is we said about fluid and electrolyte, and then we talked about the bone and calcium metabolism. The last part is that CVS and blood. Here actually I should make it. Okay, so in blood there will be anemia and bleeding disorder. Basically RBC will be less, and as we said already, that antithrombin will be lost, and there may be sometimes thrombosis also, and sometimes there may be bleeding also, depending on loss of clotting factors and antithrombin 3. So there may be bleeding disorders and anemia. Next is under CVS, there may be hypertension, congestive cardiac failure, and another characteristic thing in uremia is often there will be inflammatory pericarditis because of uremia, that is known as uremic pericarditis. So pericardium will be inflamed. Okay, so hypertension, congestive cardiac failure, and uremic pericarditis. In lung, because there is edema in all the different organs, so in lung also there will be pulmonary edema. In GIT, there will be inflammation in all the organs, all the parts of GIT. Okay, so esophagitis, gastritis, colitis, and because of this gastritis, there will be nausea and vomiting. Also, there may be bleeding in GIT, bleeding in stomach or bleeding in colon, which may pass through stool. Okay, and in nerve and muscle also, there may be neuropathy, myopathy, and encephalopathy. Now in urine, there is one particular finding, that is fixed specific gravity of 1.010. So often in chronic renal failure, we find this finding, and this is quite characteristic, that the specific gravity is somewhat fixed despite of whatever patient is taking less water or more water or whatever food intake, the specific gravity of urine will be fixed and low. Okay, so this fixed specific gravity is known as isosthenuria. Okay, hyperstenuria is increased specific gravity, hypo is low specific gravity, and fixed specific gravity is called as isosthenuria. This is again one of the important characteristic finding. This is there in your one of the practical card also, that isosthenuria is asked in that. Okay, so remember that there will be fixed specific gravity of 1010. And depending on which other findings are there, whether it is nephritic syndrome or nephrotic syndrome or RPGN, so those findings will be there. Okay, so there may be hematuria, say for example in nephritic syndrome and mild to moderate proteinuria. If it is nephrotic syndrome, then there will be obviously, as you know, massive proteinuria and lipiduria, and casts will be there. So depending on all these primary disease, there will be other findings as we have already discussed several times. Till now, all of you okay? I mean, any doubt? Please tell once, yes or no, all of you.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it looks like you're all half asleep only. Okay, so just to repeat once again, fluid and electrolyte, dehydration, edema, metabolic acidosis, increased potassium level or hyperkalemia. In bone and calcium, this is the most important in pathology which is asked maximum, is this part, bone and calcium metabolism. There will be renal osteodystrophy, increased phosphate, low calcium and secondary hyperparathyroidism. This one we have seen already, that low phosphate excretion lead to high phosphate level, and low dihydroxycholecalciferol will lead to low calcium level, and ultimately that will lead to secondary increase of PTH. That will lead to increased resorption of calcium from bone and renal osteodystrophy. This is often asked in VIVA. And in blood, anemia and bleeding disorder, CVS, hypertension, congestive cardiac failure and uremic pericarditis. In lung, there is pulmonary edema, and in GIT, esophagitis, gastritis, colitis, and this gastritis will lead to nausea and vomiting, and there may be, because of inflammation and bleeding disorder, there may be bleeding in GIT. In nerve muscle, all the nerve, muscle and even brain can be affected, so neuropathy, myopathy, and if brain is affected, encephalopathy. Encephalon means brain, okay, so encephalopathy is disease of brain. And in urine, we'll see the specific gravity is often fixed, specific gravity that is known as isosthenuria. Now last part is treatment. Now systemic features of uremia, say for example, whatever we have discussed, those things have to be treated separately, like anemia, if there is hypertension or edema. So hypertension is usually in uremic patients or in renal patients, that is treated with angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. And secondary cause, if anything is there, like say for example, if patient is suffering from diabetic nephropathy, then all this secondary cause of renal disease will be treated. Now for the renal pathology as such, in chronic renal failure, first we have to give drugs like steroids and immunosuppressants, and we also have to maintain the fluid and electrolyte balance. This is very, very important. Maintenance of fluid and electrolyte balance, depending on that, we have to give the patient, depending on how much is the electrolyte balance and sodium potassium level, we have to give more sodium or less sodium, or we have to give more fluid or less fluid. Protein also intake has to be restricted in many patients. So that is one important part. And ultimately, these patients, as you know, will progress to advanced stage. So that is ultimately they will go to end-stage renal disease. And then there are only two options. One is dialysis. Basically, dialysis means there is one machine through which all the waste products will be removed from the blood, and extra fluid also, whatever extra fluid in the body, basically there will be fluid overload, so that fluid will be removed. Okay, so it may be hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis, that either blood can be filtered, or there is one another option is that we can give one dialysis fluid in the peritoneal cavity, and that will take out all the waste products. So this is dialysis, and also we can have a renal transplant. So basically, that is surgically we have to place a healthy kidney from a donor, either from a dead person. If we take the kidney immediately from a dead person till there is any tissue damage, that can be used, or from an alive person, which is matched. Tissue matching has to be done, and we can give that kidney. So basically, that is all about chronic renal failure or chronic kidney disease. So here, the most important part is you have to remember the causes. Basically, as we said, all the causes except minimal change disease and acute tubular necrosis. And the most common cause, you remember, it is diabetes and hypertension. And another important part is in the systemic features, the most important which is asked is bone and calcium metabolism. Anyone, any doubt till now?
No, sir.
Okay. So, do you want any part of renal system to be revised, any of you? I just want to know before because next two classes I have to plan accordingly, that's why I'm asking. Any part of renal system should be revised? Okay. Okay, then good. I'll not revise much. Some few important points I'll highlight maybe in the last class, right? Okay, and also I'll give you some assignments or short questions, and what are the important questions that I'll discuss once in the last class. It's okay with all of you? Then I'll yes, right? Okay, fine. So then, yes, okay, with that, then we'll finish then today, right?